Welcome to the award-winning World Footprints podcast. I'm Tonya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick. Today we're stepping back into history as we visit the Liberation Pavilion at the National World War II Museum in New Orleans. Join us as we explore the profound narratives of liberation, the aftermath of World War II, and the enduring impact of the war on the modern world.
Our guide today is Michael Bell, whose extensive knowledge brings these stories to life in a way that is both moving and enlightening. Let's dive into this remarkable journey through time.
As we begin our tour, Michael Bell introduces us to the stark realities faced by soldiers and civilians during the final days of World War II. The Liberation Pavilion does more than just recount historical events. It immerses visitors in the experiences of those who lived through the war. From the Battle of the Bulge to the discovery of concentration camps, we gain a deeper understanding of the war's human cost and the resilience of the human spirit.
You know, liberation is a much larger one. What's the legacy of the war? What does the war mean today? How's that? So for most of the visitors, though, they'll finish on either the road to Tokyo or road to Berlin. We're going to go into the last couple galleries of the road to Berlin, just to give you a sense of kind of how people would experience that, if that works. Okay,
sure.
Good. Okay. So we would have been in there going away. So this is part of Road to Berlin. We're in the Battle of the Bulge in the Ardennes Forest. You know, December 1944 is a massive German counterattack. It'll be the largest land battle the army will fight. And you really set this context of, you know, what's the experience? Obviously, it's not cold in here, but it's pretty cool. I had several veterans, one's like, who did you have your advisor? This is exactly how it felt.
Walking through the exhibits, we encounter powerful artifacts and personal testimonies that highlight the complexity of liberation. One such story is that of a Jewish American soldier who discarded his dog tags to avoid persecution if captured. Michael explains how the liberation of concentration camps not only revealed the atrocities committed by the Nazis, but also underscored the importance of documenting these horrors to prevent future denial. These exhibits remind us of the importance of memory and the role museums play in preserving history.
So one of the soldiers in the Battle of the Bulge is a Baum. So pretty amazing. He's going to be tasked, though, in the spring of 1945 to lead this mission to break through German lines, go deep, and try to rescue American prisoners of war, to include one, this Patton Settle. Patton tells him, if you succeed, I'll get you the Medal of Honor. Well, they don't succeed. Their vehicles are destroyed. There's more prisoners than they're told. They're in bad shape. But he's Jewish. And so as he tries to work back to the lines, he'll throw away his dog tags. So you don't know what are the Germans going to do with a Jewish officer in the process. Another thing that I find interesting with Abe was as in his oral history describes, you know, you're attacked by teenagers, you're attacked by kids. The war gets incredibly messy as the long story goes in. This is a side we don't think about much.
Oh my God.
Blurring the lines between who is nice.
The pavilion also explores the immediate post-war years, focusing on the immense challenges faced by displaced persons and survivors. As Michael guides us through these galleries, he emphasizes the global efforts led by the United States to rebuild and promote democracy. The exhibits on the Nuremberg trials and the establishment of the United Nations illustrate how the war's end marked the beginning of a new era in international law and human rights.
About 17 million Americans will leave their homes to go work in these defense jobs, for one. And for many people, this will be your first regular paycheck after the Depression. But 6 million women will join the labor force.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's interesting is more than half of those are actually married women. You know, typically, married women wouldn't have been in the workforce, but
Yeah, you got to make ends meet. You know, my grandma worked in an ammo factory. It's a Presto pressure cooker factory, making artillery rounds. She had three kids. And, you know, that was, and about 2 million of the women will stay in the labor force after the war. Now then, for the women in the military, first they create the Women's Army Auxiliary Force. That'll become the Women's Army Corps. They expand the nurse corps. So the Army had about 7,000 nurses when the war starts, and the Navy had about 800 Navy Reserve nurses. So the nurses will expand drastically. The Army is going to create about 600 hospitals during the war. You know, how do I really take care of my people? I mean, you're fighting more numerous enemies. I need every person I can. So medical is huge. The big question for the Women's Army Corps is, what jobs will you let women perform? And so initially, some of the male bureaucracy said, oh, we're only going to have like three specialties for women. They'll ultimately open up about 62 specialties for women. You know, they've got some allies in Congress that help with that and, you know, open that up. And you'll see them, you know, they could be admin, intel, engineers, but also code breakers, ferry pilots for aircraft. The idea for the Army Air Corps is, we need the men in combat here. Maybe we can use some of the women to ferry the aircraft to the theater, you know, or bring it from the factory. And so I think it really fundamentally will transform, you know, how we perceive who can serve and how those aspects. Same with the African-American experience. It, you know, you end up breaking down these barriers. For instance, you know, before the war, you know, the Navy only has mess men. There's no African-American Marines.
Yes.
And the Army has segregation by regiments. But as the war goes on, you might have African-American units supporting these other regiments. They actually will have what's called the fifth platoons, where you'll have an African-American platoon in a white company. We're so many levels down. So now you have people literally serving together on the battlefield, which I think fundamentally changes how people see people. You know, you have a shared experience in those pieces there.
In one of the most poignant sections of the tour, we hear the voices of liberators and the liberated alike. The Liberation Theater presents firsthand accounts of American soldiers who witnessed the aftermath of the Holocaust. These oral histories are a powerful testament to the bravery and compassion of those who fought to restore humanity in a world ravaged by war. Michael's narration helps us appreciate the enduring relevance of these stories in today's world.
I think this building, if you think about it, you know, how do we reach, you know, my kids are in their 20s. They're amazing. They're amazing kids. But I think in many ways they see World War II as amazing and large, but they're not clear why it matters. And this, I think, should convince anybody, whether you're into that technology, social change, human rights, you know, America's role in the world, whatever it is, there's a link to that, why that matters and why this should inform our judgment about world events today. And so I think in many ways, this is kind of the, you know, you could come to the museum and just come here to this building, you know, I think, I mean, you know, obviously we want you to see everything and do all that, but this could be a visit in itself. You know, many states now have Holocaust education requirements. I think the first floor would be incredibly powerful for that. You know, and then just obviously understanding the larger piece. So there's mine.
And it's all in the books. And love the facts that you guys and
hear that the team. Yeah, I mean, our goal was to expand that. You know, how do we reach more people? How do you have a relationship with the museum? Maybe it's school groups, maybe it's online programs. You know, how can we be accessible but also the trusted source? You know, it's based on facts and evidence and I think that becomes a really important aspect.
Our visit to the Liberation Pavilion at the National World War II Museum has been a powerful reminder of the sacrifices made and the lessons learned during one of history's darkest periods. We hope this episode has inspired you to reflect on the importance of preserving our past to build a better future.
Thank you for joining us on this journey. If you enjoyed today's episode, please subscribe to our podcast and share it with your friends. Until next time, keep exploring the world with open hearts and open minds.
This World Footprints podcast with Ian and Tonya Fitzpatrick is a production of World Footprints LLC, Silver Spring, Maryland. The multi-award-winning podcast is available on worldfootprints.com and on audio platforms worldwide, including iHeartRadio, Pandora, Alexa, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, Public Radio Exchange, and many more. Connect with the world with a deeper understanding through powerful stories. Visit worldfootprints.com to enjoy more podcasts and compelling articles from international travel writers. And be sure to subscribe to the newsletter and receive a free gift. World Footprints is a trademark of World Footprints LLC, which retains all rights to the World Footprints portfolio, including worldfootprints.com and this podcast. The views and opinions expressed on the podcast and website are those of the guests and authors and are not necessarily endorsed by World Footprints LLC.